Councilmember Chapman, Councilmember Clayton.
Here.
Councilmember Kendall.
Here.
Deputy Mayor Quinn.
Here.
Mayor Moore.
Here.
Move the city manager's report on issues raised at prior council meetings.
I have nothing to report at this time.
Special events applications, Leisha.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. The first application before you is March for Babies, which will be held on May 7th from 10 to 2. Next is the Asbury Park Kite Day, sponsored by the Chamber of Madison Marquette on May 13th.
That's new, right, Leisha?
Yes. To be held on 7th Avenue Beach on May 13th between the hours of 11 and 3. The Haitian American Heritage Society is asking to use the council chambers for their event on May the 20th, that's a Saturday, between the hours of 11 and 2. Mayfest Beer Run on May 21st, sponsored by the Beer Garden. It's a short run between the hours of 10 and 11 a.m. Super Safe Summer Event will be held at Springwood Park on June 10th. Between 11 and 4. Iglesia Pentecostal Church would like to hold their revival in Sunset Park on June 17th. Garden State Equality will be holding their annual Equality Walk on June 17th. Asbury Park Day is requesting to use Springwood Park on June 24th.
Remind me to tell you.
Best Day Foundation is asking, they do a surfing event every year for kids with special needs, and they're asking to do that again on July 22nd. Diva Dodgeball would be held on July 22nd on Fifth Avenue Beach. Cathedral International would like to hold their ocean baptism on July 30th on Sixth Avenue Beach. The Chamber of Commerce would like to hold Oyster Fest in Bradley Park, September 8th through the 10th. Local Mala Project is a yoga event that will be returning on the boardwalk on September 17th. And lastly, there's a wedding request for August 5th on 6th Avenue Beach. Thank you.
Any questions? No? Thank you.
Next item on the agenda is a presentation by Ezio Altamora for insurance. GJ.
Thank you. Good evening, Mayor, members of the governing body. My partner, Matt McGarrow, is handing out a little packet.
Thank you, sir.
Mayor, what I'm going to do is bring the governing body through our annual review of insurance. So just to give you highlights, this is just snapshots of our insurance program that the city of Asbury Park has. I've got some loss information I'm going to share with you. My card is in there. If any member of the governing body has any questions during my presentation, please just ask me to stop and I can answer any questions. I do have my partner, Matt McGarrow from GEM Insurance Agency with me. Eric Nemeth, I think most of you know, is the attorney for the NGIF, and Maria from Polaris as well. So if you look on the right side of the packet, the first page is just a highlight of what we do as the insurance agent risk manager for the city of Asbury Park. I want to thank the governing body for your reappointment this year in 2017. If you go to page 2, it explains and it shows some of the public entities that we insure in our office. We're statewide in New Jersey. We're licensed in 38 or so states. This is what we do. We do public entity business. Page 3 is the resume of the principals, myself, my partner Joe. Some of you have met Joe, and my partner Matt, who's with me here tonight, which goes through page 4. If you go to page 5, I thought it important for the first year as being appointed by the governing body as your risk manager to give you a chronological view of what we did last year when we were first appointed by the governing body January 1st. So that's a chronological listing of the visits here to Asbury Park. One of the first things we did is we met with your public works superintendent and we're taking around and we photographed and cataloged every property, every location that the city owned, compiled the information and sent it to Polaris to make sure that there were no missing locations. So as you work down, you can see the many visits we made to the city last year with the cooperation of your department heads. If you go to page 6, I put on the top there that working with your safety program, working with your department heads during our quarterly meetings, with Maria, who's Director of Public Entity Operations from Polaris, which are the administrators of the New Jersey Intergovernmental Insurance Fund, and with Eric, a lot of the initiatives that we put forth would not be possible without their professionalism, and I thank them because they really cooperated with me and my firm and with the city of Asbury Park. One of the things we were able to do is negotiate lower deductibles for the city, which started in October 1st. So on page 6, we actually, because you'll see it in a minute, the loss trends were so positive last year with the cooperation, with the help of all your department heads and the governing body, we were able to reduce deductibles on worker compensation, which is on page 6, tied into lost time accidents. On page 7, we reduce your general liability and your auto liability deductibles as well. So these are all tiered reductions in deductibles, which are a benefit and a savings to the city of Asbury Park. In addition, on the bottom of page 7, with the help of Eric and Maria, we secured a $10,000 program monies for your police body armor camera program. So that check was delivered in February to the city of Asbury Park. If you go to page 8, this is what they call the risk management plan that's filed with the state of New Jersey every year for the fund years 2017 to 18. And this is just a highlight of major coverages. If you go to page 9, that's an introduction to the New Jersey Intergovernmental Insurance Fund. It's been in existence since February 1st of 1991. It has approximately 21 members. And the city of Asbury Park became a member on February 15th of 2011. If you go to page 10, that's the operating philosophy and procedures from page 10 to 12 of how the assessments work, how the safety works, how claims are brought in with professionals through PMA. So if you jump to page 12, they talk about the defense, which is Eric, and Eric is very active with the New Jersey Intergovernmental Insurance Fund. You've seen him before the governing body, and he does a great job, and our office and Eric work very well together in handling some of your claims. Page 13 is actually how claims are handled through PMA, which is the third-party administrator. There's safety and loss prevention through PMA. Litigation management and legal fees are all handled through Eric and his attorneys. Page 14 begins the coverages provided by the New Jersey Intergovernmental Insurance Fund. So that section there gives you a snapshot of its automobile liability, worker comp property, cyber liability, police professional, public officials, and employment practices liability are all covered under the blanket coverage program under the New Jersey Intergovernmental Insurance Fund. If you go to page 15, these are the actual nuts and bolts of the coverage. Again, it's a snapshot of your limits, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it, but from pages 15 to 23 are the limits and coverages offered to the city of Asbury Park. So if you jump to page 24, these are additional coverages that we write through our office that are not part of the NGIF program. So last year we implemented, at our recommendation, we put an accident program together and worked with Leisha, your recreation director. So now we have your children in your summer rec program, karate, boxing, soccer, swimming, and mentoring activities now covered for first party medical coverage. So should a child get injured and they either have no health insurance or they have high deductibles, this policy steps in and covers up to $100,000 with no deductible. We also have an underground storage tank policy in place because the NGIF doesn't cover that. They only cover above ground storage tanks. So this is a private policy we put forth. There's an emergency response hotline, and your public works superintendent is aware of that. If you go to page 25, and this is where I'm just going to ask you to look on the left side of your packet, this is just some thoughts about risk management. If you pull to the left side of your packet, I had PMA put four colored loss run history for the last 3 years, so you can get a sense of the trends from 2014 through 2016. So the first document is the worker comp document, and you can see a substantial reduction in both frequency of claims, which we in risk management feel are more important than the severity of the claim. So we don't like a lot of small claims because they lead to large claims. The trend has been very positive. You look at the column that says total incurred, the dollars and cents paid by the NGIF substantially reduced last year, and that's a testament to the governing body and to your department heads. And that's workers' comp, the first sheet. The second sheet is liability. So this includes all kinds of liability that's covered under the NGIF. Again, if you look at the total incurred column and you look at the total number of claims over to the left third down, you can see the reduction and you can see it in the bar graph. 2016 was a stellar year for the city of Asbury Park. The reductions have been phenomenal. And again, that's a credit to this governing body. If you go to the third page, that's the commercial auto. So that would cover auto claims if your vehicles hit someone, or a property claim, or damage to the vehicle itself. Not a lot there, but look at the substantial reduction from 2014 to 16. You can see the bar graph on the bottom is a substantial difference, substantial. And just, the last sheet Yes, Mayor.
The public knows. Read that number.
So
in 14 to 16.
In 2014, the city of Asbury Park experienced total incurred claims in the auto liability category of about $663,000. In 2016, it was $13,272. Substantial reduction. And I credit the governing body and your department heads. Again, a reduction in frequency and severity all across the board. And the last one is property. The city of Asbury Park does an excellent job. These would be fire and flood type claims to buildings. You really have no claims. It's essentially there are no claims. On the left side of the packet as well, is this is something that I give out at the quarterly safety meetings, but it's a document I put together, recommended by the Jem Otterstedt Insurance Agency. I've been working with Michael and some of your department heads. When you bring in vendors from the outside, I've worked with Leisha and Cassandra. We like to look at their contracts. We want to make sure there's hold harmless indemnity agreements in place. We get certificates of insurance so that the city of Asbury Park is protected. And the last document on the left side is basically we follow the plan of risk management as your risk managers, and that's kind of the flow chart that describes what we do. We came in, we analyzed the risk, we made sure we cataloged it, we knew what we had as exposures. We worked with Maria on your renewal applications to make sure we had all the vehicles. Chief Ketty has been great. I mean, he is so instrumental in your safety program here. He does such a fantastic job. I can't stress that enough, that the leadership with him and with Michael, it's been great. So this is what we've done for you. Again, I put it on the bottom of page 25. Special note of thanks to Michael and to Fire Chief Kevin Ketty. They've been great in working with our office. So again, I thank you for the appointment. Does anyone have any questions?
Any questions? Okay. Keep up the good work.
Thank you. Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, members of the council. Does anybody else have any questions subsequent? Just give me a call. Our cards are in there.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you for your time.
The hell of a reduction.
Yeah.
Well, that's why I wanted them to read it.
No.
Next on the agenda is a presentation for 1003 Bond Street.
Evening.
Good evening,
Mayor, Council. Mark Steinberg on behalf of the applicant. I don't know if Michelle gave a report. You know, we keep missing each other.
Yep.
We keep missing each other. In any event, what this is about is a request for an easement from the City of Asbury Park for the aisle between the parking spaces and the curb, which seems to be owned by the City of Asbury Park. Now, I know there's certain questions on it, so let's just do the presentation first. This is the, and we handed Michelle small copies of everything. She hasn't handed anything out, or you have it.
Mm-hmm.
You've
yes.
seen it. Okay, basically this is the development of the Holy Spirit property, which is going to be condominiums, and the project's been going on for quite some time.
I don't think that's the right way. I think it's upside down.
I think you're right. Okay, so, this is Third Avenue. Parking is diagonal along Third Avenue. And the curb line is out here. And it turns out that the city owns what we see in the darker green. Michelle had asked us as part of the development, correct me if I'm wrong, that the curb, the sidewalk be widened?
No, the sidewalk should stay the same.
Right.
Just to put the curb between the sidewalk and the parking lot that should be at least 12 inches high in order that when a car backs up from the parking lot, so the trunk or what's between the end of the trunk to the wheels will not be able to hit any of the passengers of the people who walk on the sidewalk. And then on top of the curb to put another 3-foot fence to complete a 4-foot divider between the sidewalk and the parking lot.
And the width of the sidewalk is?
It's done, I believe it's 3 or 4 feet.
Right, and then beyond the sidewalk there's a grass area?
There's grass area
with the
I think
trees?
It's another 3 trees, I think that it's another 3 feet.
Okay. That's all on the city right way, sidewalk
yeah.
And the street. We're talking
and
about
the 15-foot. That's what we're looking for the easement, the dark green.
The dark green, which is the width of that is 13 feet. 13 feet.
So
and
13 feet of the right of way you're asking for.
Correct.
Am I understanding that right?
Well, we're only asking not to own it, but for an easement to use it to cross so that we can get to our parking spaces. And of course, as part of that easement, we'd have the responsibility of maintaining it. Now, the parking lot from the original, I guess Holy Spirit was the church.
Which was with, I have pictures over here. That's the existing, so you can see that all of that area is paved. It was used, it was always used as a parking lot for the school. Because that used to be the school for the Holy Spirit Church. And so you can see on the, if you want, I'll come closer to you so it will be easier. So you can see the existing is paved and it was used by the school all those years. I think it's 50 or 60 or maybe even more. That's what will, I'm sorry, yeah, that's how it's gonna look after it will be finished. The only change will be that we'll put the fence and the curb.
Well, when you're not the original owners, right? You're not the original people who, right?
No, that property went to a few owners.
So is there a way to do the parking without, meet the parking requirement without the easement?
No, because there's no place for the cars to back up.
Now this site plan was approved by the planning board.
Yeah.
Some time ago.
2007.
It was the zoning board, actually.
The zoning board, and that wasn't part of the application process.
And are the spaces going to somehow be deeded to the units? How is that going to work?
The units will be able, each unit will be able to buy the parking lot.
Parking space.
One parking space.
Yes.
But the easement.
But there's 17 units, right, and only 16 parking spaces.
There are 16 units.
16 units and
yeah.
16 parking spaces.
Yeah.
Okay.
They would only own the parking space. They wouldn't own the area behind the parking space, the cartway, basically, to get to the parking space.
And how tall is the wall?
The wall 12 is going to be 12 inches, and on top of the 12 inches will be another 3 feet of fence.
And what kind of fence?
It's going to be a steel fence.
Well,
a black steel fence?
Yeah. Jarrett open fence, an estate fence, basically, right?
Yeah.
Jarrett, G-E-R-I-T-H.
So the resolution of approval that was adopted by the zoning board back in 2007 for this project had a condition indicating that this approval is subject to the approval of mayor and city council of any encroachments into the city right of way. And the applicant has indicated that the parking spaces themselves are on the area of the property that is under their ownership,
correct.
But that the aisle to access the parking spaces is technically within the city right of way, even though it's
inside the paved area
and
inside the
curb,
and it's part of the. It's more than 13 feet. That width is larger than 13 feet, but 13 feet of the cartway to get into the parking spaces is what we're looking for the easement.
Okay. And when we're giving easements, we're looking. If you're asking the city to give you an easement, we like to look at cost, right? So you know. paying for the easement, right? That we're not just gonna give away pieces of the city, right? Particularly 13 feet. Is that something you talked to Michelle about, or at all, or zoning?
Never came up.
Okay.
I was aware of that possibility from your attorney. So I don't, you know, you want us to buy the easement, we'll have to.
Well, we just don't wanna just give 13 feet away, right?
Well, you don't give it away. The easement is only the right to cross it. You still own it.
But you use it during that period of time.
Forever.
Forever.
That's true. And, but on the other hand, if you wanna deed it to us, then you can tax it. If you wanna buy it and deed it to us, then it becomes part of the tax bill. And right now, I would assume that square footage is not, and I don't know for sure, it's probably not included in the taxes for the square footage of the property, for the land.
Okay.
If you feel that it should be purchased instead of giving us an easement, give us a price. I don't know how that's calculated. I think
or that there would be some consideration for the easement.
Right.
Or there,
okay.
Or the tax would be higher because of the easement.
Okay.
We can certainly review that with the assessor and also review what the assessor believes to be an appropriate value for the value of the permanent easement that's being requested.
And there's no way to do the parking without the easement?
No.
Okay.
The one of the problems is, of course, the building existed that was converted, and I don't believe that the building was expanded or changed in any way.
No,
so
no, I know the building. It hasn't been changed.
So that existed. So then you have to back in, if you'll excuse the pun, the parking.
Right.
On the site.
Okay.
And there's place for the parking. There's sufficient room under your ordinances and whatever variances were granted for the angle parking. But we need that strip, which was always part of the parking lot, because I don't know when the original school was built, probably in the 40s or 50s. That was the parking lot.
Okay.
And we developed it. Okay. Now, we're looking for, I don't want to push anybody, we're looking for a quick as possible turnaround, only because it's done, right?
The building is 98% finished. The only thing that holds us back right now is the parking lot.
Oh, wow, okay. It didn't, really? I'll have to ride by it.
I'll invite you for a visit.
Okay.
I don't know if we could set up a meeting with the tax assessor or I can push it a little forward and see what we can do.
We can certainly do that.
Should I contact Michelle? I don't know who.
Michelle is away right now. I'd suggest through the city. You can contact me and I'll go through the city manager.
Right, maybe we can get a meeting together and see what, you know, you can figure
this
that out.
This would require an ordinance like we've done in the past for granting a permanent easement if the council is so inclined.
Okay.
And,
sure.
And, you know, if there's a cost basis that can be reconciled. So I will contact your office and ask you to set up a meeting as soon as possible with the tax assessor, if that's okay with everyone,
sure.
So we can move forward.
Mm-hmm.
It's got to be, we've got to figure it out so that we can open up. And that's, we were here before.
When did you buy it? Ballpark. I mean, I'm just curious. Ballpark. You don't have to give me the date.
About 10 years ago. I'm sorry, about 8 years ago.
8 years ago. Wow.
Yeah.
Which was after the approvals. It was probably in about 2009 or 10. And the approvals were 2007. And we're just, you know, I only got into the picture a couple months ago.
Okay. Very good. Thank you.
Do you want to show the boards? Just turn them around so the public can see them?
Sure.
Very nice, thank you.
All right, next item on the agenda is a presentation by Sackman Enterprises. The first one for 512 Summerfield Avenue will be tabled at the request of the applicant. And the second item is a presentation regarding 574 Cookman Avenue.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Andrew Karras on behalf of Sackman Enterprises. We called two people to provide some testimony tonight. One of whom is not here yet, Mr. Sackman. He was on the turnpike when I spoke to him a while ago behind an accident, which is clear. He's on his way down. Hopefully he can get down here pretty quick. Marlucci from Inglis Architects with regard to the proposal, the conceptual plan that we have for the property. Just to give you a little bit of a background on the property, the entity that purchased the property is Seacoast Realty, entity affiliated with Sackton Enterprises. The property that we're talking about, we affectionately call the Barry Schlock Building, which I think everybody is familiar with.
I call it Legacy Drugstore.
It's an old building. It's an old bank building. It's rather deteriorated. I don't think anything's been done to the building in about 50 years or so. The bones are beautiful. It's a magnificent structure if you look behind the deterioration that has occurred over the past 50 years. My client recently purchased the property. Just to give the address, it's 574 Cookman Ave, Block 3105, Lot 6, here in the CBD district. As we all know, it's located right on Cookman Avenue, part of Cookman Avenue. With all the development that's occurred around it, it kind of sticks out as an eyesore. Although the building is in itself a magnificent building, the way it's been maintained has created an eyesore in the entire downtown structure. It is a historical building. Because of that, any attempt to obviously renovate or restore the building has a significant cost that's affiliated with. The permitted height on that particular building is 45 feet. What we're looking for is to increase the height so as to add some residential floors above it. And the reason for doing that is if we want to maintain the property as a historical structure, to be able to actually bring back the building, both the exterior, which requires a significant amount of work, and the interior. The inside of the building is absolutely magnificent, although when you go inside, a lot of it's tough to see. It's a huge interior of the building, but it is rather dilapidated. To bring it back to its past grandeur is going to require a significant financial investment to give it the type of finish and the type of work that's required of it. In order to do that, we're going to have to add, and we're looking to add some residential on top, add a few floors to be able to, number one, provide additional residential space in the downtown, but also to be able to financially subsidize the restoration of this magnificent historic structure. When we look around in the area, you have varying heights within the CBD district. You have the CBD plan that provides for a lot of different heights for different properties. That plan also has been amended over the course of a number of years, many years, in fact. What we have, we look at the various sites. You have on 550 Cookman Ave, the property that had been restored by the Sackman companies, has a height, it was approved for 60 feet with 5 foot setback. So that is up 60 feet. Previously it had been staggered under the CBD plan between 45 and 60 feet. You have behind it, property in Lake Ave, that's at 60 feet. You also have across the street, the Steinbeck building, which is fully restored property from the Sackman companies at 70 feet. We have the Post building that's across the street that had been subject to a plan amendment to allow it to go up to 70 feet, which was done in 2005. You have the 607 property that had been subject to a plan amendment that allows it to go up to 96 feet, although it's an interim parking lot right now, it's a parking lot. So you have right across the street property that's at 70 feet. There's a permitted height right now on the building that we're talking about now, 574, 45 feet, but you have surrounding properties that go up pretty high, up to around 60 feet and even exceeding 60 feet. The plan that we're submitting, that we're looking at here, originally with the submissions that we presented before the board had in there 82 feet, we've dropped that down. We're looking to increase the height of this building through a plan amendment, since we are in the CBD zone, to 70 feet to be able to accommodate the structure we're looking to add to this historic building. And with that background, what I'm gonna do is call to testify Mr. Marlucci, who's an architect that has designed the property, if I may.
Okay, thank you. For anybody that's not familiar, the property is located at the corner of Cookman Avenue and Emory Street. I'm on page 3 in your booklets. The booklets that I handed out are a revised version of what you have previously provided to show the 70-foot, 10-foot reduction in 70 feet. As Andy mentioned, the property is in the CBD redevelopment area district. And on page 6, you can see just a few existing conditions photos on Emory Street looking south and on Cookman Avenue looking east. What we anticipate at this point is for a ground floor use of commercial or retail with the residential lobby located along Emory Street. Just to orient you, this is Cookman and this is Emory, with an office tenant located on that back half towards Lincoln. And then in the new addition portion of the building, which I'll talk about in just a moment, we're looking to add three stories with seven residential units on each floor, ranging from studios to one bedrooms and two bedrooms. So now I'm on page 9 in your booklet. Architecturally, an addition above a historic building is a unique challenge in that you want that addition to be complementary to the historic fabric, but also not to compete with it. So in this case, the addition needs to read as if it's part of 2017, but it also needs to relate to the rhythm and the architecture of the original building. So this series of diagrams walks you through the process that we went through in order to design what we think is an elegant and sophisticated response to the original structure.
Wait, because that was my question. So it's like you took a historic building and then put something modern on top of it.
Correct.
So that was what you wanted to do.
That's exactly what we did, yes. Yep. So this is a series of diagrams that explains our process and how we got to what we're proposing as the design for this property. We started by adding the three-story volume on top, just taking the footprint of the building and bringing that up to add the three stories.
And how many units again, just for my memory?
21, 7 units per floor. The next thing we did was to pull back the facades on Cookman and on Emory from the existing facade so as to deprioritize it from the main facade so that it reads lesser than or behind the existing facades. Third, we took the third floor or the first floor of the addition and we set that back 5 feet. So the goal here is to create what we call the hyphen or the belt on the building, which reads as a break or a clear break between the historic portion and the new portion. Even though that is part of the historic portion, it creates a shadow line and a recess that transitions from the historic up to the new construction. You can see that in the rendering, which I'll talk about. The next thing we did was to start to respond to the rhythm of the arch top windows and the pilasters on the historic building below, is to draw this line up where the rhythm changes and express that on the addition above by pushing back the back third of the building, which is this area in orange. Next, we took the rhythm of all the pilasters and we extended those lines up onto the new construction portion, which you can see through these dashed red lines in the orange areas to create these void sections. And then last, we took those orange areas and we pushed them in. So all this was trying to respond to the original rhythm in a way that you could relate the modern design to the historic rhythm and design of the
So can I, and listen, I'm not a planner.
Two distinct elements.
Yeah, and I'm not a planner. So let me continue to preface that. So it's like an unmatching outfit to me, right? So why wouldn't you want, if you have a beautifully historic building, wouldn't you want on top of it something that is reminiscent of the beautifully historic building?
I'm going to respond to you.
Sure.
Using fashion, because you said an unmatching outfit. So I would say that I would typically not wear a black shirt and black pants. I would wear black pants and a white shirt. Because you want
You
that.
Know I have black shirt and black pants on right now.
I couldn't see
that's what I'm saying. I am wearing black pants and a black shirt.
Well, you could.
Wow.
That's one option. But you could also wear gray and black.
Right.
So the idea is not to let them... Look, this building was built at a time when the masonry that was used was very ornate and very intricate, and we wouldn't want to try to replicate that above because
why,
we never
though?
Because
why
we never
do
it
do
as
that?
Well. We
okay.
would never be able to do
okay.
it as nice
from
as the original.
From a restoration standpoint, you want the modern portion of the building to read as if it was built today, and you don't want something that's going to confuse someone to think that this was originally a 5-story building.
But why? I guess I'm just not understanding
just,
why.
This is Jack and Glaze, also the architect.
Why wouldn't you want the building to mesh together like black and black? Like what's? And I'm asking this because I'm not a planner. I'm not saying you don't have a logic to it. I'm just not understanding.
No, I think the goal is to be able to bring a new life to the building and to be able to show that this is a historic base, right? This is a historic building, and it was original life.
Okay.
And we are restoring the building, and in doing so, we're bringing new life to it by adding this new piece to it.
Okay.
A modern extension on a historic building.
It's a good question, though. And I do sometimes wear black and white. describing this. I just want to look at page 11 quickly with you. So this is an elevation on the Emory Street side. This is just to demonstrate the overall height that we're proposing here. So the original building to the top of the new podium is approximately 35 feet, and then the new floors are 11 and a half feet each. So that brings you to a total height of 70 feet to the roof, which is 70. The extension. So on the rendering, you can start to see that the rhythm that I was talking about, the pushback of the belt or the height in between the historic portion and the new portion, the bringing up of these pilasters onto the modern pilasters above, and then the setting back of these, which were created as balconies along the length of Emory Street and a feature balcony on the corner. On page 13 is a second view. This is from the Lake Avenue side, looking up towards Emory. You can see the Steinbeck building in the distance, which is very similar in height to our proposed building. And again, the same treatment with the pilasters and the historic rhythm extending up onto the new structures.
And you can see the job back a little bit better.
Right, where this sets back.
Where the pattern of the existing building came in.
And then what I want to just share is our material palette that we're proposing here. So what I'm showing on the rendering bench is what I'm going to pass around. The stone is meant to represent the historic stone. What we're proposing in white is a composite gloss panel, which is what you see here. We're proposing a dark wood soffit, which is the material you see underneath that transition up to the historic portion and in the balcony areas, and then a dark gray for the windows and the railing. So I'll pass these around just so you can see the whole palette.
One thing I want to clarify, the proposed structure that we're looking to add to the historic building, that doesn't cover the entire site, am I correct?
Right. The
why don't we just clarify?
The existing building is an L. The portion that we're building out is only this rectangle with frontage on Cookman and on Marie. This back leg is not
the back portion of the L stays, the three stories of the town.
Okay.
And I think this view, I think, is helpful in speaking to the height issue. This is really at a fairly complicated intersection of Madison, Cook, and Emory, and I think it relates, it relates fairly well to the scale of the Steinbeck building, which is its biggest neighbor across the street.
Now, just getting back to the design, how old is that bank building, do you know?
I would say it's about 8 years old.
I would say it's probably between 1910 and 1930.
That has a very distinct architectural style that
sure.
was developed in that time, am I correct?
Yeah, classical revival is a very common, it was a very common building style for banks in the early part of the 20th century.
So this design is intended to highlight that structure and not take away by copying it anywhere else on the site, am I correct?
That's correct. This is an object in and of itself. It still stands alone, and pulling this back helps separate the two from each other. Even the activity on the third floor is mostly happening behind the parapet of the existing.
Any questions with regards to the design that's been proposed, the height?
I got nothing.
How many entries is there?
I'm sorry?
I only see one. I know it's have to be one in the front. The entry point when you walk in?
The entry point.
It's two or three?
The entry point to the residential is on Emory. There's an existing entrance at the, I want to say the lake end of the building on Emory that right now, or originally, was access to the offices that were at that end of the bank building. That's going to become the main entrance to the residential. And then the entrance to the retail on the first floor will be on, probably on Cookman and Dorian.
And the parking is going to be where?
There is none.
There is none, I know.
There is no parking on the site. There never was, there isn't any.
No, okay.
The ceiling height on the interior of that building is about 28 feet?
Yeah, it will be about 28 feet, yes.
And that will remain with regards to the restoration development of the site.
In the front large area, that's where the arch views are.
When you go in there, you see it really is magnificent. You walk it, like I said, it's painful and down. It needs a complete restoration, but the size and the scope and the height is magnificent to have that restored, you know, to bring it back to complete that Cookman Avenue corridor. I think would be something special. I intended to call Carter Sackman. I'm trying to find out where he is to offer some additional comment. What's that?
Should be a hold.
We're gonna, if we can just take a few minutes to check where he is. Normally he likes to assist in the presentation.
But up top, so.
No, we were talking about pass-throughs of the building.
As you know, the city planner is away this week on vacation, and I'm sure the mayor and council is gonna wanna hear her comments.
Absolutely. Absolutely. If we can just have a few minutes to check where Mr. Sackman is.
Yeah, go ahead.
I'd like to go present it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Do you wanna move on to the rest of the agenda and come back to that?
Do what?
Do you wanna move on to the rest of the agenda and come back to that?
Yeah, what else do we have?
Just the review of agenda matters and matters. That's it. Alright, we're gonna move on while we're waiting for Mr. Sackman to review of agenda items for this evening's meeting. Kevin?
Okay. Resolution 2017-141 is a resolution approving alcoholic beverage control licenses for Asbury Lanes LLC in the city of Asbury Park, County of Monmouth. Any questions can be directed towards Cindy. Resolution 2017-142 is a resolution to approve person-to-person liquor license transfer from AP Vines LLC to 934 Shrive LLC for 644 Cookman Avenue, also known as Lush. Any questions?
Does this mean there's a new owner?
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Resolution 2017-143 is a resolution amending the temporary budget appropriations for the 2017 budget. This is standard in moving monies around until the final budget is adopted. Resolution 2017-144 is a resolution authorizing the payment of bills. It's a standard payment of bills. Resolution 2017-145 is a resolution accepting an award of a grant from Municipal Open Space Program and authorizing signatories. The city has received a $250,000 from the Monmouth County Open Space towards acquisition of Bradley Cove. This resolution also authorizes the city to receive the grant and sign any paperwork associated.
And just so the public knows, this is in addition to a previous $250,000 grant for open space and a $1 million grant for Green Acres.
Resolution 2017-146, authorizing a professional services contract to T&M Associates to perform services for intersection improvements at Springwood and Atkins Avenues. This is for design and construction management services for the intersection improvements at Atkins and Springwood Avenue. Originally, we intended to do Springwood and Ridge intersection, but that intersection has costly utility relocation issues. Springwood and Ridge would require moving the double catch basins and the rising of existing utility lines. Quite simply, this would be very expensive, and we do not have that in the budget. So we are proposing the improvements for Springwood and Atkins. This is paid through this year's capital program. Resolution 2017-147, a resolution authorizing change order number 2 with BlackRock Enterprises for the road program. This is a change order to pave a small portion of Berg Street. It's the section of Berg Street between Asbury Avenue and First Avenue. Resolution 2017-148, a resolution authorizing the award of a contract for emergency services radio coverage testing. The city has a few areas where police radio coverage is less than ideal. The resolution authorizes a state contract vendor to survey the entire city, including inside the high-rise buildings, to determine coverage so we can best determine how to proceed with the department's, with the police department's new radio system. This is being paid for out of a capital ordinance passed towards the end of last year. Resolution 2017-149, a resolution authorizing the purchase of pickup trucks for the Department of Public Works. Two of these DPW trucks were authorized in the 2017 capital program. The other truck is being paid for out of the beach utility. One of the existing DPW trucks will be given to the Environmental Shade Tree Commission so they do not have to use personal vehicles. The other truck will be kept internally for the mechanics. The new trucks are on state contract. Resolution 2017-150, a resolution authorizing the purchase of three police cars. This is the now annual replacement of three police cars paid through the 2017 capital program. These vehicles are on state contract. 2017-151, a resolution authorizing the purchase of an Elgin Pelican sweeper to Timmerman Company. This is for replacing a street sweeper, and this new sweeper is off a national purchasing cooperative. The purchase is part of the 2017 capital program. We will keep the old sweeper until the new one is received and we ensure it is operational. At that point, we will then be requesting a council resolution to auction off the old sweeper. Resolution 2017-152, a resolution awarding a contract for improvements to Fourth Avenue. The city accepted bids for Fourth Avenue improvements last week. The improvements are sanitary sewer replacement and a complete road reconstruction. $340,000 of the total cost is paid through a New Jersey Department of Transportation grant, the rest through capital expenditure. Anticipated construction will start this summer. The construction will be phased in block by block to minimize traffic issues. This award is $250,000 less than the engineer's estimate. If there are no change orders, we'll be able to reprogram the remaining funds to mill and pave another smaller road. This is not determined what road could be milled and paved, and we will not make any recommendations until this project is near completion. Resolution 2017-153, a resolution accepting the Department of Transportation bicycle pedestrian assistance. The city has been awarded a free technical assistance to develop a bike pedestrian plan through the New Jersey Department of Transportation. This resolution accepts the free technical assistance and allows the city manager to sign any paperwork. When the assistance is finished, the city will have a planning document that will guide implementing activities to improve pedestrian safety. And as far as ordinance 2017-18, which proposes changing the zoning and the light industry district, can be adopted Wednesday, as the planning board found changes to be consistent with the master plan and has formally voted.
It cannot be adopted tonight because we need to advertise.
Okay.
So that's pulled.
All other ordinances are on, all.
Sorry, go ahead.
It's okay. All other ordinances are on for second reading, have been discussed, and are ready for adoption. And that is all I have for the agenda.
Thank you. Any questions?
Go back to the presentation.
Mr. Sackett is here to add some comments to the application, not the application, but the presentation.
Questions?
Go through. We already presented the presentation, the conceptual terms of the plan, so we're going to go through the underlying reasoning why we're looking to add the stories onto the building lines necessary to go up to 70 feet to be able to do this.
Okay, so the goal here is on the interior is to maintain a one-story structure inside, which is a 32-foot height. It's got a coffered ceiling, and the goal is to maintain that, and what we're really looking to do is under the 45-foot height, it's really typically a four-story type zone, ground up, and the idea is to try and maintain that four-story so that some of the economics can still be realized in this particular site, which obviously will help us restore the existing structure, which will be a substantial cost. So that's part of the play on that. I think
If you look at the surrounding areas, certainly Catty Corner, we did a restoration of an old historic site with Woodrow Wilson at 601 Madison, also known as the Bank Building. We contrasted the rear of that, that went up 72 feet, and we contrasted the rear of that with something that we didn't try to match. We tried to kind of exploit the historic aspect of it, and so I thought that that was a nice design. I think this across the street here, we have a zone that's 60 feet right now, and
right now 45. You're talking about this property?
No, no, this property is 45, but adjacent to us is 60 feet on the 545 Lake. It's also 60 feet, which we didn't do on the 550 Cookman. We decided at that time to set that back. We added a setback third floor to what is it's an Art Deco building, 550, that you don't know it, but where Toulouse is, that run there, it's a gray building that runs about 200 linear feet. That's also 60, although we didn't exercise that height. This particular one we thought could be kind of like an iconic building, and it's different. I understand for some people they might like it, and some other people might be like, whoa, that's an old historic building. And you've got like a contrasting modern. That was, again, trying to magnify and kind of focus on what is historic and not try and match what would be a very difficult thing to try and match. So we felt like the height was very, very similar. Again, across the street, not just 601, but actually Steinbeck, which we have, is also in excess of 70 feet. So we thought we were in keeping with that corridor while kind of trying to create something really special and interesting with the 574 site, the one we're kind of like presenting here tonight.
Garter, you mentioned 601. In a sense, what you did on 601 is similar to here, where you took a historic structure, it was restored, and then the addition that you put onto it, you did a more modern or different look so as to accentuate the historic building, correct?
Yes, so exactly right.
And that's similar to what you're planning on doing in this particular property, am I correct?
Yes.
Any
okay.
Questions? Comments?
No, thank you.
Okay. Anything else you want to add?
That's all that. That's it.
So as I indicated to Mr. Parris, as you may know, Michelle Alonzo is away this week. The council is going to want to hear from her as to her planning report on what you have proposed. If council is amenable to this proposal, then it does need a plan amendment to the CBD. So they would adopt a resolution forwarding this to the planning board for the planning board's recommendations, and then it would come back to the council for the adoption of an ordinance to amend the CBD, just by way of procedure.
Okay.
Thank you so much
for
your time.
Thank you.
All right, we'll move on to matters by council.
The Earth Day cleanup was canceled because of the weather last Saturday, so it's going to be this Saturday. We're meeting at City Hall at 9 o'clock, and the cleanup is targeting the Memorial Drive corridor from one end of the city to the other. Of course, we always need volunteers. And we're also going to be having a free cycling marketplace. That means when you're doing your spring cleaning and you have items that you'd like to donate, you can just bring them to the parking lot. We're spreading them out. And anybody that wants to pick up and take home. So your junk is someone else's treasure. And here's an opportunity to do that. And also on Saturday, the police department will be collecting old medications. So here's an opportunity to get new things that you may have in your home that you no longer need, and we don't want going into our water system. So, thank you.
Last Monday at the Springwood Avenue Park, we had a great time with the kids. It was a fun day, kids' day. The Recreation Committee joined in with the Boys Club, and we had over 350 kids or more. And the kids are still talking about it. I got a lot of reply from family members that said thank you for having this, and they're looking forward to the recreation, the Boy Scout, working with them in the future. But I just want to thank, we have quite a few volunteers, and I want to thank each and every one of them. We have close to, I guess, 40, 50 volunteers, and we appreciate everything that they did. They took their time out, and they had fun with the kids. And I just want to say thank you to each and every one of them. That's it. Thank you.
I have a couple of things. On Sunday, April 23rd, John and I got to see Yvonne being honored. And not only honored, but presented with a proclamation declaring April 23rd Yvonne Clayton Day, which from the Monmouth County Freeholders. So that was a really great day. And then Asbury's gotten a bit of good news in the last 2 weeks. We got the LTA grant, which is going to be a grant to help with the bicycle lanes from, which is gonna help us with the bike share program that we're doing. So I'm sure Michael Manzella is gonna be reaching out hopefully to some of the community organizers and getting feedback on that. And the other thing that we have been working on for probably a year and a half or 2 years is Wi-Fi on the beach, to kind of use that as bringing people to the free Wi-Fi on the beach, to bring people to the beach to do their work or whatever it is that they want to do. So that is now up and running. So those were two great things that we got off the ground in the last, I'm going to say, month. That's it.
I have nothing.
Matters by city manager?
I have nothing at this time.
Matters by the city attorney?
And I have nothing at this time.
All right, I guess right now we'll move right along into the regular meeting. We did the roll call already, so let's please rise for a silent prayer and a moment of reflection, please. Flag salute. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. As to comply with the Open Public Meeting Act, Chapter 231, Public Law 1975, adequate notice of this meeting has been provided in the following manner. The annual notice was forwarded to the Asbury Park Press, the Coast, and the Star Ledger on January 3rd, 2017, and posted on a bulletin board the same date. All notices are on file with the city clerk. There is a proclamation listed this evening for Arbor Day, recognizing Arbor Day for April 28th. This will be presented at another time. So next we'll have a motion to open the meeting to the public, please.
Second.
Anybody who wishes to come up and speak, please state your name and address for the record, and each member of the public has 3 minutes to speak.
Hi, Phyllis Mafucci, Deal Lake Drive, and as many of you know, I'm also a real estate agent. One thing I want to say, though, first to Yvonne's announcement about the Marketplace Free Exchange, that's taking place prior to the citywide yard sale. And I don't know if that's just a one-day event, but I was going to suggest that maybe you do it again after the yard sale, because whatever I don't sell, I can certainly have a place to bring it to. So, and other people might feel the same way as well. But I'm here today because I had a really frustrating day this morning, or I should say experience, with getting a CO for a short-term rental. And last year I was told that a two-family could rent for the summer as long as they got a CO every time the property turned over. And at the meeting, we were also told that nothing was going to change until September because it wasn't fair to homeowners if they have their property already rented. Well, I was told by the inspector that I should take my sign off the property because I'm confusing people and I'm not supposed to be getting a summer CO, and that two families were not allowed. So I just want to clarify that the information that I have is correct, or perhaps this inspector has some other information that I'm not aware of. He also said that they got an email, a very lengthy email on Monday, talking about all of these changes that have taken place. So if I could perhaps get some clarification on that.
So I would like to follow up on it, but the summer, so a summer SEO, right, is something that we did to kind of make the lives easier for some people in Asbury Park who wanted to rent out their place, you know, a little, whatever, over the summer, however many times they wanted to do it and didn't want to get a CO every time. So in 2014, we did the summer CO, which is absolutely still in effect in the summer of 2017. The only thing that is confusing me about your facts, Phyllis, is that your client, if it's a multifamily, which are not on the summer CO list as of yet, you know, that's certainly something we're having a dialogue for the more comprehensive short-term rental discussion, is there would be no need for you to get a summer CO. You just have to get a new CO every time.
Correct. So each time the house turns over, another inspection takes place and we get a new CO. And that's what's been happening.
Right.
According to this inspector, I'm not supposed to be doing
that. Do me a favor, Phyllis, send me the name of the inspector, email me the name of the inspector, what he said, and I'll follow up with Rob.
Okay. And another, I mean, there's a couple of things that I wanted clarification on. I was also told by code enforcement that you can no longer go to City Hall and schedule a CO inspection within a couple of days. You need a 10-day advanced notice. And that was as a result of an ordinance that came about in December. He told me that I should go onto the city website and look at it because it's on the city website. And I've been on the city website two or three times and have not been able to find that ordinance. So those are a couple of things that I just wanted clarification on. And I know I'm out of time, but it did inspire me to write a short-term rental proposal. I don't really have time to read it, but I'd be happy to give you each a copy of it so that you can look it over. I know this is an ongoing conversation, and you did mention about any suggestions, so I do have something here.
And within the next week or two, we're actually reaching out to local real estate offices to get feedback from the local agents. So, one, Phyllis, we pass ordinances all the time. I don't know if we passed that in December or not. I can certainly check. And two, if you can just send me an email with these two issues and your proposal, Yvonne will bring it back, and we're absolutely open to reading what your suggestion
is. Okay, and the other thing is, if that is in fact true, that you do need 10 days advance notice, how do you put that information out to people? Because not everybody obviously comes to these meetings. Not everybody's checking the website, even if they are there. So I would think that that's something that the public would need to be notified if you do, in fact, need a 10-day advance notice to schedule a CO. So just something.
Yeah. Agreed. Listen, I voted on it, and I don't remember, Phyllis, so yes,
maybe
I agree.
Maybe it will help because there was a comprehensive property maintenance ordinance that was adopted in December, and it was ordinance 2016-53, and that may be the ordinance that you're referring to. So we could definitely get you a copy.
Okay, great.
Good evening, everyone.
Can you email me, Phyllis?
Yeah.
Hard copies. Okay.
Good evening, everyone. Christian Hall, 1114 Asbury Avenue in Asbury Park. I just left a meeting for Asbury Park Day, and I just wanted to bring back a few notes and some thank yous from that meeting. We discussed about the park. There's two sidewalks or two pieces of sidewalk around Library Park, and one of the families there, they brought up an issue saying that the sidewalk was a little damaged, so it was just a concern if somebody would have tripped or anything during the event. Also, I wanted to thank you all for your continued support with the continuation of the planning and everything for Asbury Park Day. And also, some of my neighbors, community members that live on Washington Avenue, they want to meet to thank you all for going through with the paving of Washington Avenue. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you. What's that date? June 24th? Mention the date.
Oh, I'm sorry. Asbury Park Day, June 24th, is going to be a citywide event. Hopefully everybody comes out, has a great time, and enjoys themselves. And again, thank you, everyone here, for your continued support.
Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Doug McQueen for Wesley Court, and I'm here on behalf of the Asbury Park Complete Streets Coalition. I want to thank you and congratulate all of you on the recent receipt of the local technical assistance funds from NJDOT for a bike and pedestrian master plan. That bike and ped master plan will be a big milestone towards making Asbury Park a better place for pedestrians and bike riders of all ages and abilities. I'm sure that us obtaining that plan is in no small part thanks to Asbury's continuous improvement in its approach to making city streets and sidewalks more accessible to people of all ages and abilities, and so we really appreciate that. And I'm sure that's also in no small part, I'd like to thank you and congratulate you as well on the hiring of our city transportation manager, Mike Manzella. He's an energetic young guy that brings a lot of expertise to the table, so I think that he's made a tremendous impact. It's fantastic.
He's fabulous. He's absolutely fabulous.
As far as the development of the bike and pedestrian master plan, as always, the Complete Streets Coalition just wants to offer our help and assistance, and in fact request as an interested stakeholder group to participate with the city in every way that we can. So you know how to get a hold of us, and please reach out. Thanks again.
And Doug, why don't you send Michael Manzella an email as well, just letting him know that you're interested in.
Absolutely.
That Complete Streets is interested in providing him.
We will. Thanks. Oh, we'll CC you on that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Marty Bradshaw, 1508 Main Street. I have the Burns Bradshaw Realtors. I'm following up. I had a meeting 2 months ago with Michael Capobianco regarding my mercantile license. On my mercantile license for last year and also for this year, it says license type real estate agent. And my conversation with him was about the fact that I made the argument that if you're a realtor, a member of the National Association of Realtors, the status should rather be a professional office. And I have here the copy of the new ordinance that you just passed last December, where you have professional services, accounting, legal, medical, and other such services provided by a formally certified member of a professional body. So the National Association of Realtors I had an article here from the Realtor magazine. This was a few months ago in the Realtor magazine. As the largest trade association in North America, the National Association of Realtors prides itself on the high levels of expertise and professionalism its members exude. Being part of the association on the local, state, and national levels means you've made a commitment to yourself and your clients to provide a superior level of service. So, you know, we definitely meet the criteria of your definition for a professional office. So anyway, I never heard from him. It's been 2 months. He said he would get back to me as far as changing my license type. And then about a month after that, I left a message with Tracy Berms because he wasn't in that day, and I wrote him a note, and when I called her the next day, she said I did give him the note, and I requested in my note that he contact me, and again, I never heard from him. So that's why I'm here tonight, to try to get an answer on this. I would like to have my mercantile license changed to read professional office, not real estate agent. There is a difference. Oops, sorry. In other words, you can be a real estate agent just by having your license from the real estate commission. But when you're if you belong to the National Association of Realtors, that gives you you can wear the little pin like I'm wearing right here. You can have their trademark, the big R. You can display it in your office and on your cards, which I do. So there is a difference.
Okay, thank you, Marty. Mm-hmm. Do me a favor. Give Kevin your telephone number, and I guarantee you Mr. Capobianco will call you tomorrow.
Okay, thank you.
And Kevin?
Yep.
Please pass that along.
Okay. I'll give you my card.
Thanks. Okay, thank you.
Okay, 732-776-6844. Marty,
that's Burns Bradshaw, Main Street, Asbury Park.
Right.
Don't be shy. Yes,
we've been there for 90 years.
Good evening, Pam Lamberton, Sunset Avenue. I just wanted to comment on three things. Number one, I wanted to ditto what Doug McQueen said. Congratulations that the grant of the LTA is fabulous, and we will continue to work in front of the scenes and behind the scenes, as we always have, to make things happen for the city, and we are here to help, so congratulations. Second thing, people in the city who also support what you're trying to do, I do not believe it is a problem waiting to happen. I believe you're being very proactive, and it's a good idea to get control of it ahead of time. I know you're not proposing any, you know, restrictions that will make it absolutely impossible. You're approaching it reasonably, and I'm sure you will come up with a good solution. The third thing having to do with 574 Cookman Avenue, I just wonder if it's time and if you can possibly require them to provide a certain amount of affordable housing, a low-income housing in that building that they're proposing to build. It's time we kind of moved some of that housing elsewhere in the city, spread it out, get some of these developers who are willing to come in and spend big bucks in the city and support some of our low-income neighbors. It's been done in other communities. Jim Henry and I have lots of experience out in Somerset County where it was done, and it is invisible. Nobody realizes it's there, but it provides excellent housing for those who need it. Thank you.
Thank you. And when Michelle makes her report on 574, that was going to be one of my questions, but I didn't want to ask it tonight without Michelle being here.
Okay. Hi, Rita Morano, 8th Avenue. I attended the planning board meeting on Monday, but evidently I missed a couple of the meetings on this one project. I can't believe they're going to build a building between Moonstruck and the Beer Garden and lose all those parking spaces, and plus the fact we still don't know how many parking spaces they're going to have, I don't think. I didn't hear any numbers. Mr. Saxman is a very smart man. This building that's going up, I guess it was in the plan from what, 2002 or 20, I don't know when the plan was changed. It started in 2002. He was supposed to build a parking garage right behind the press building. Now, why can't that happen? If we have to let him develop that piece of property because it's in the plan, it's also in the plan that he has a parking ramp. Instead, he has a private parking lot that he charges $125 a month for parking. Now, is that right? Is that the way we're going? Those people that were sitting there that worked for him, they're as sharp as a tack. Those are all New York people, and it's very hard to compete with them. And I know you tried your best, but you cannot let Mr. Saxman get away with no parking. And this other building that's going up, no parking there? I didn't hear anything about parking. This is a very serious problem, and I think you know that. You have to solve that problem before you let any other construction go up. People are riding around for hours looking for a parking space. I have one next door to me. He came for a week. He parked his car in front of my house, not on the property, which they have plenty of room to park. There was more garbage. It's a no-no. And the other thing I thought you should put in the ordinance is that you've got to be 21 to rent, or else you're going to be creating 550 Cookman Avenue is becoming short rental. You're creating a very bad problem here. I hope you stick to that ordinance that you created with a few changes that you wanted to make on the short-term rental. Have we got the ordinance tonight or no?
No.
I guess you're still working on it, right?
Correct. No ordinance has been proposed by this council.
Now, the other question I wanted to ask, I forgot. I just remembered.
Okay.
Did you raise the fee for for Saxman, say he has to buy the parking spaces?
Yes.
It's not $3,000, is it?
It's $15,000.
$15,000?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, that's better, but they still have to have parking. I mean, I just couldn't get up and talk to you the night because I didn't. Okay. I didn't have the knowledge. I mean, I wasn't at those other meetings, so I didn't know how you voted. Instead of like one person up there was worried about the color of a door or whatever. I mean, I think you should be worried more about parking and that big wall that's going to go up for those people on 550 Cookman. And that's it.
Thank you.
So you're still working on the ordinance?
Yes, that's why we were meeting with everybody. We met with the Monmouth County representative for the real estate agents. Like Amy said, we're going to meet with the local real estate agents. We met with the people who are opposed to what we're thinking about, and they don't even know what we're thinking about, so how they can be opposed to it, I don't know. Because we haven't decided on anything. We're not going to be like Tom's River and do it five times. We want to do it once and do it right and make the majority of the people happy. And you're never going to make everybody 100% happy, but we'd rather get all the feedback and do it. And right now, anybody who's going to rent in Asbury Park in July, rent it 6 months ago. I mean, so probably all the bookings are filled. And I don't go on the Airbnb page or the short-term rentals, but I'm sure, so to put something in place right now would be counterproductive, and we promised there would be another public meeting, and that will happen also. So nothing's in writing, still being thought about.
But remember, most of these people that are complaining do not live here, because I questioned them that Saturday. Some live in Princeton, others live in New York, and they're not changing their address.
Okay.
So you don't have to worry about that, Bogie.
Hello, Mayor and Council, Jerry Scranton, Long Branch. Okay, first of all, I think we should say congratulations to everybody who ran for the Board of Education election, and real glad we have the top voters did win. I'm glad with that. Okay, the other thing is, with the new buildings going up, we really have to make sure there's plenty of parking, because when they did some of these ideas 15, 20 years ago, we needed something to happen. And as we'd had mentioned, people do ride around for a period of time, and then they just go to Clancy's or some other place close by to go eat, because they can't find parking spots. Now, the new building that they're doing, that's a historical building, they're saving the facade, and they're gonna be putting the new building on top or within the footprint, a smaller on the top part. I couldn't tell by looking at the picture. That's the problem with the pictures. If you don't do 3D or a small model, it's hard to tell exactly what's going on. So if they're putting a new building on top of an old building, the building that was historical is no longer historical, because you're changing the inside structure also. Some of these old bank buildings, the big building, was because of the grand space inside them, not cut up. The other thing is, a town, Ridgewood or Westwood in North Jersey, they're eliminating short-term stays. They have to be 30 days or longer. And one of their concerns was that the cars were parked on the street and not off-street parking. And I had brought that up to you guys, that anybody doing short-term rentals should have parking off the street for those cars. In Jackson, within the news, was on a MLS post, they were warning us realtors that they're not allowing people to put signs on the dead man's grass. That's the grass between the sidewalk and the curb. I guess before driving, pulling in out of driveways, they figured the signs can create obstruction. I remember when people were putting signs on the building for sale, and Barbara Van Wagner shut them down for putting signs on the building. It happened like maybe 10 years ago to a big sign. So it's a safety issue not to have signs in that dead man's walk. So maybe we could just advise people that's not a good idea. And how are we doing with the monthly meeting reports? Are we getting them? Are they online?
I don't have an answer for that, Jerry.
Okay. The only one I had to add. Okay, thanks a lot.
I apologize. Right. But Kevin, we'll ask Michael, and yep, we'll get back to you the latest the next meeting.
No problem.
Good evening, Warren Hall. Pastor of Deliverance Temple Church, 504 Prospect Avenue on the corner of Pine Street and Monroe. Mayor and Council, Chief, our illustrious attorney, I'm very excited about Asbury Park Day. I am so very, very excited that we are expanding Asbury Park Day this year, that will include the open air, all arts in the park at Library Park. We are going to have gospel at Deliverance Temple Church, which is on the corner of Pine Street and Monroe at 504 Prospect. And on Springwood Avenue, at this new Springwood Avenue Park, it's going to be a Family Success Interaction Fun Day with lots of interactive activities for the whole family. And we're going to have a scavenger hunt to bring it all together, because we want the conversation to continue. You know, the conversation about community and about how we can work together. It's an icebreaker so that those of us who've never met before, we get to meet, we get to talk, we get to be friends, we get to recognize each other as neighbors. By the way, the event at 504 Prospect Avenue is called Love Thy Neighbor Day. And we're going to be giving out clothes free, food free, for anybody who needs clothing or food. And we're going to have services available, tables for people from social service agencies. Whatever you have to offer to people in the community who are in need, we thank you for volunteering, for coming out to support. We really appreciate it. And for the arts community, welcome, welcome, welcome. This All Arts in the Park is, we hope to have every type of art that there is. We hope that every artist and all those in the art community will fully participate. And I'm so grateful to the mayor and council and the chief for continuing to support community and Asbury Park.
Hey, Warren, do me a favor. I know Christian left. At your meeting, somebody raised a concern about some of the slabs at the Library Park.
Yes.
Can you, like, have Warren give the specific location? I mean, we should be able to go over there and find them ourselves, but I mean, if it's that much of a worry, and since we're going around town and giving everybody summonses, I mean, we should be fixing our park also.
Yeah, thank you for the summons I got also. I will certainly make sure that Christian identifies that for you.
Right.
But you reminded me of something.
Oh my.
Yes. But I forgot, so don't worry about it.
Okay. Thank you. Hey, Kevin, just pass that along to Bill.
Yeah, McClave. Christian, he'll see me before she's in jail, probably.
Hey, Doug, you're only supposed to get one bite at the apple.
Oh, I waited online. I thought I could go again after everyone's.
Nah.
No, that defeats the 3-minute rule, Doug.
But if you got something for 10 seconds, go ahead.
Yeah.
No.
We'll give you 10 minutes then, Doug.
I already gave you compliments in 3 minutes, so I should get 3 more minutes. It was just a comment about parking. I know that parking is always a concern. It's a challenge that's presented by our success downtown. But I'd like to take a slightly different perspective than Jerry and Rita and say that the experts will tell you that surface parking lots just kill downtowns. They absolutely kill the ability to create a compact, walkable, safe space. Obviously, structured parking is a great goal and something we should strive towards, but the economics are very difficult. So I would just suggest, through either our parking committee and the council, always keep in mind the advice of the experts, and one in particular is an expert I've told you about before, Donald Shoup, who wrote a very famous and thick textbook called The High Cost of Free Parking. And in it, he explains that you have to manage your parking properly, and it's not just about providing an endless supply of surface parking spots, because that'll absolutely kill downtowns.
Okay, thank you. Motion to close.
Move it.
Second.
All right, we're on to minutes. We have 3 sets of minutes this evening. Executive session for April 12, 2017. Workshop minutes of April 12, 2017. And regular minutes of April 12, 2017. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Any comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton.
Abstain.
Councilmember Kendall.
I'm sorry.
Say yes.
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 This is minutes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn.
Yes.
Mayor Moore.
Yes.
We're on to the consent agenda. Resolution 2017-140, resolution approving special events application. Resolution 2017-141, resolution approving 2016-2017 alcohol beverage control license for Asbury Lanes. Resolution 2017-142, resolution to approve the person-to-person liquor license transfer from AP Vines LLC to 934 Shive LLC for 644 Cookman Avenue, which is also known as Lot. Would anybody like any of those resolutions removed from the consent agenda? Hearing none, can I have a motion?
Move it. Second.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Individual resolutions. Resolution 2017-143, resolution amending temporary budget appropriations for 2017 budget. Can I have a motion to approve, please?
Move it.
Second.
Any comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2017-144, resolution authorizing the payment of bills. Can I have a motion to approve, please?
Move it.
Second.
Any comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
No.
Resolution 2017-145, resolution accepting award of grant from Municipal Open Space Program authorizing signatures. Can I have a motion to approve, please?
Move it.
Second.
Any comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2017-146, authorizing professional services contract to T&M Associates to perform services for intersection improvements at Springwood and Atkins Avenue. Can I have a motion to approve, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2017-147, resolution authorizing change order number 2 with BlackRock Enterprises for the road program. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Any comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2017-148, resolution authorizing award a contract for emergency services radio coverage testing. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2017-149, resolution authorizing a purchase of pickup truck for the Department of Public Works. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2017-150, resolution authorizing a purchase of 3 police cars. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Any comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2017-151, resolution authorizing the purchase of Elegant Pelican Sweeper to Timmerman Company. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2017-152, resolution awarding contract for improvements for 4th Avenue. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2017-153, resolution accepting New Jersey Department of Transportation bicycle pedestrian assistance. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second. Comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
We're on to ordinances, public hearing. Ordinance 2017-16, ordinance establishing salaries for certain employees within the city of Asbury Park, Monmouth County. Can I have a motion to open ordinance 2017-16 to the public, please?
Move it.
Second.
Seeing no one speak, can I have a motion to close?
Move it.
Second.
Can I have a motion to approve, please?
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2017-17, establishing restricted parking space for use by handicapped persons at property located at 302 Third Avenue in the City of Asbury Park, and amending and supplementing Section 7-36 entitled Handicap Parking of Chapter 7, Traffic of the Revised Zoning Ordinances of the City of Asbury Park, New Jersey. Can I have a motion to open ordinance 2017-17 to the public, please?
Move it.
Second.
Seeing no public, can I have a motion, please?
To close, move it.
Too late.
They have a driveway there, and they have a huge staircase going up. They have a handicapped person living in there. It's right next to the Gill home.
It's right next to whose home?
The Gill home. Well, it used to be called the Gill home. I don't know what it's called now. But they have a staircase and a driveway that goes all the way around. Why would they need a handicapped space? Especially there, three blocks from the ocean.
Well, they provided whatever documentation is required by the police department in order to get a handicap parking space. I don't think we could really ask for much more than that.
If there's a handicapped person in there, how does he get in there? Is what I want to know. There's about 10 steps going up to the porch.
Handicap is not necessarily just being physically that you can't walk, though. You can have a handicapped parking space and still be able to walk around.
I know. He might be handy. I don't know who it is, but that's a multiple dwelling to begin with, so there's a lot of people living in there. But they do have a driveway. I mean, I could see if they didn't have a driveway and they needed a handicapped space, but why can't they use their driveway?
Can they park in their driveway?
I mean, you know, spaces are limited as it is. I'm not saying anything. He's probably handicapped, but I happen to know the house.
Well, if it's multiple dwellings, Rita, maybe they don't have access to the driveway, right? Maybe the tenant who lives on whatever floor they live on parks on the street.
Well, I don't know.
I don't know either.
Yeah, but, I mean, they should look at these things more carefully. See
what's going on there. Motion to close to the public?
Move it.
Second.
Sure. Motion to adopt ordinance 2017-17.
Move it. Second.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Sorry. Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Ordinance 2017-18, ordinance amending the City
That's
of Asbury.
Cold.
Oh, I'm sorry, you're right.
Actually,
I need a motion to table,
okay.
Please.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Motion to table 2017-18.
Move it.
Second.
And if you can just announce the new date,
yes.
That will be considered for a final reading and public hearing.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
This resolution will be rescheduled, or ordinance will be rescheduled May 10, 2017. Ordinance 2017-19, an ordinance amending and supplementing Chapter 2, Form of Government, Section 2-1.4, Non-Discrimination Policy of the Code of the City of Asbury Park. Can I have a motion to open the meeting to the public, please?
Move it.
Second.
Motion to close.
Move it. Second.
Motion to adopt.
Could
move
you explain
it.
That a little bit?
Read it. When we open the public session, you got to move then. We can't wait for a delayed reaction. So we already made the motion to close it. What it is like we cannot discriminate. All we're putting in our book is we cannot discriminate. We're adding language to the policy manual.
Okay. Motion to adopt, please.
Move it.
Have a second?
Second.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Ordinance 2017-20, authorizing the City of Asbury Park to convey an easement over certain portions of public right-of-way area adjacent to properties located at 1105 Memorial Drive, 1109 Memorial Drive and 900 Fourth Avenue, Block 302, Lot 7.01, formerly known as Block 302, Lot 7, 8, and part of 6, respectively. Can I have a motion to open ordinance 2022 to public, please?
Move it.
Second.
Rita, do you want? No? Okay. Motion to close.
Move it.
Second.
Motion to adopt ordinance 2017-20.
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Clayton.
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall.
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn. Deputy Mayor Quinn.
Yes.
Mayor Moore.
Yes.
Okay, that's fine.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.